Bruce Smirnoff joins us from Delray Beach, Florida. Hello, Mr. Smirnoff.
David, it's been a long time, hasn't it?
It's been about 8 years.
Something like that. Yeah, we last saw each other in Las Vegas. Todd Glass was opening for David Spade, and then we all up with Avi Lieberman. We all went up into Todd's suite, and we laughed our asses off.
With my son. My young son was with us.
That's right. Oh, and I kept asking, is it okay for me to swear? Or, you know, that's right. And you said it was okay. That's right. How about this show? Is it okay to, do we keep this G-rated, or where's the language?
Let's keep it G. Okay. Let's keep it G-rated. That was one of
that goes to show. I got to go. That's it.
That was one of the happiest days of my life.
I concur, because I had moved to Florida in 2003, and I love living here. But what I miss the most about Los Angeles are the show business people, because it's a laugh-a-thon at any moment. And here, it's anything but. Most of the people here, even people my age, I'm 60 now, but, and I have friends that are like 55 to 65, they're all on Prozac. I don't know if your listeners know, when you're on Prozac, I'm not, but evidently your lows aren't so low, but your highs aren't so high. So I'm around these people, like you're a comic, and you know when you're funny, and I know when I'm funny. And yet when I'm with all my friends down here, it's just like, you know, it's just like that. I say things that are the funniest things in the world, and they just stare at me. It's not, and they like me because they think I'm funny, but they just don't laugh because of the medication. So that's unfortunately a lot of people down here like that. Very few people laugh like you and I and all the, you know, all the comics when we're together in a room.
You are still working as a stand-up. You're still doing cruise ships.
It's amazing. Here, I'll give you a litany. In Los Angeles, I left in 01, early 01, because I had really exhausted everything. I did that one-man show that we'll talk about a little later. I almost got something to happen on one of the networks, and then they just said, it ain't happening. And then I figured I saved money to make what's called a digital. I was going to make a digital film. Digital film was just like burgeoning then. So I went to school to learn it, digital filmmaking, and I got the money to make it, wrote the script, and then Larry David's show came out. And of course, it was so close, and Larry David's show is, you know, one of the greatest things ever. And once I saw that, and then they renewed it. Didn't he get renewed, I think, for like 8 years after like the first episode? And I just said, that's it. I mean, you know, it's like they've been trying to send me a message, and message has been received. Took 23 years to get the antenna up, and the message, yes, I have interpreted it, and I'll be leaving on the next train. And that was it. So I went to New York for like 2 years and went to Brooklyn. I was living in Brooklyn. I went to Bay Ridge, Brooklyn. Do you know that?
I know of it.
It's like Mafiaville. And I went there because I was friends with Richard Jenny and his family. And they live in a nice area of Bay Ridge. And they showed me the area. It was very safe. It wasn't in that artsy fartsy area, which is now, you know, 12 years later, you can't even buy anything for $1 trillion. You know, where all the yuppies have moved, or all the hip kids in near the Hasidic area in Williamsburg and that section of Brooklyn. So I was living in like Mafia USA, and it was great because I didn't have to lock. You didn't have to lock your doors. There's just nothing. No one is going to come near you. I was walking to the bus stop one day because you take mass transit, and my neighbor's kid, who I didn't know, but I saw him come out of like a couple of buildings down. He must have been really high, and he was walking towards the bus, and he rolled his sock down, and he had a juicy fruit gum thing. And in the juicy fruit gum thing was a joint. And he pulled out the joint to smoke it, but what was also in the juicy fruit thing was a rolled up $100 bill. And I was 50 feet behind him, and I picked up the $100 bill, and I'm going, I'm in. I got $100. This kid's so high. I got $100. And then I go, what if somebody saw me? I'm in Mafia. This is like... This is cement shoes. This is no fooling around. These are the real people. And I ran, and I played this all out in my head, and I ran after this like idiot 13-year-old kid, and I went, "You drop this, like, you know, like he's gonna, you know, call the mafia on the phone and go, don't kill him, don't, you know, he's got a pass, he's okay for like a month, right?" So that's where I was living, and I was living, you know, like, do you remember I was living on Beverly and Weatherly, which is basically Beverly Hills. And I moved to like Brooklyn, and I would go, I was so happy to be in New York, and I'd go into shop owners and go, "Hi, I'm your new neighbor." And they're like, "Yeah, where you move here from?" I go, "I moved here from Beverly Hills, California." And then they would just have this look on their face, like, "Are you out of your blanket, you stupid mother?" I go, "I love it in Brooklyn." And they, no one would talk to me because they just thought, because I was walking around with like this giant smile on my face, mm-hmm. just to be away from Los Angeles. So I go to the gym, and I work out like in the afternoons, and there's all these like 20-year-olds, 20-somethings at the gym, and they're all, you know, just like out of the movies, tough guys, the whole thing. And I walk over and go, "Hi, can I work in?" "Get away, I'll kick your ass, get away." I'm sorry. So wherever I went, I was like a pinball, you know, just bouncing off the bumpers wherever I didn't fit in. So one night I'm on at Dangerfields, and I look in the front row, and all those knuckleheads from the gym are in the front row, and I'm killing, and their mouths are touching the floor. You know, and I'm brought on stage as one of Andrew Dice Clay's opening. I opened for him like about, I don't know, 2 weeks, but I'm allowed to wear that moniker. And these guys, from that day on, I would go to the gym. They cleared people away. "What does he want? He wants to do bench? Get off the bench. He's going on. He's from Dice. He knows Dice. He's getting on the bench." And so it was just crazy. But I left because I really couldn't handle it. I took a couple of winters and I couldn't handle it. So, and the other thing was, I did move to New York to wash show business out of my system, not to wash stand up, but to wash the gotta make it. Who can I call? Where can I go? Who's going to see me? Who can I network? Because I was addicted, like everyone is, like you have to be in this business. And I just felt that was an ugly side of me, and I just wanted to put it away. And I was able to put it to rest in New York. I was getting one-nighters. I was really in at the comedy clubs. God bless Lucian. Do you remember Lucian from the comics?
Of course.
He was so nice to me. He welcomed me with open arms. You know, it was just like being on at the Comedy Store and the Laugh Factory. I left there on, you know, Prime Time great spots. And I went to New York Prime Time great spots at two or three clubs there and the one-nighters. But then that last Comic Standing show started. And Jay, you know, is like my buddy. Jay's done so many wonderful things for me. And nobody called me to audition for it. And I caught myself.
You're talking about Jay Moore?
He was the host, I think, the first year, producer. And I'm like, Jay didn't call me. I'm not getting, no one's calling me from there. And I caught myself with that old Hollywood feeling. Why not me? Why is it this guy? Why isn't it me? Why isn't it me? I should be, it should be. And it's ugly. And I really past that, you know what I mean? I was like 46 years old. As all these guys will tell you, there comes a day where if you're not going to break through, you got to wash this out of your hair. So to get back at myself, I moved to Florida, also because of the weather. I mean, I needed one other pushing thing. So I moved down here.
To get back to yourself, not back at yourself.
Okay, either way. No, I did it as a punishment, but yes, you could say to get back to myself. I wanted to wash this out of my system. So I came down here and I wanted to go into business. I was left a very nice inheritance. I'm very, very lucky that my parents are, but I wanted to like learn about a business and get involved. I wanted to do like a coin operated laundry. These people, I want to go into business with you. Well, what do you, I'm a comedian. I want to, no one would, you know, and I've got the capital. Let's open up a coin opera. Let's open up a yogurt store. No one wanted to get involved with me. And now, meanwhile, I'm here and I've been here before, like in the late 90s, early 2000s, opening for stars at these condos, which are huge here. And so once these agents knew that I was here, they started throwing me gigs. And that's not a problem. That was great because the gigs pay a lot down here compared to what they pay in New York and, of course, what they pay in LA, which is pretty much nothing. And I had to readjust my act because I had dirty material, and I had like sick jokes, like you have to have when you're on a contemporary comedy club. But you know, these are like your grandparents, your parents, and or your grandparents.
So you're saying that you can't tell sick jokes to an audience that's is already sick, so there's
they're sick physically, but you can't tell sick mentally jokes,
right?
You know, and like I had the joke, you know, my grandmother had Lou Gehrig's disease and Alzheimer's disease. She swears she hit 100 home runs, but she never remembered when. And, you know, and I go, I shouldn't do that joke because grandma's no longer with us. We traded her to Cleveland. You know, you can't do it because like one third of these people either have it or going to get it. The husband's got it. The wife's got it. And you lose the audience. And the audiences are what's the word? Homogeneous means the exact same, right?
Yes.
Hetero means different. So the audiences here are heterogeneous. It's all Jews. They're all from Northeast. Many are all from Brooklyn. So it's not a good scientific cross-section, but it is what it is. It's phenomenal. So they all react exactly the same to a joke. So if you do a joke, they don't like to go, can you hear that noise, you know, making that Jewish sound? And they and like it sounds like crickets. You can get a whole room. So you have to learn. And I learned, and it took me about 3 years from 03 to 06 to get really good. And in the meantime, most of the comedians down here were men that were guys. If you get some of these books about the old time Miami guys that never broke through, but were really funny. And there was a big circuit here. Sammy Shore, for example, was a big Miami act in the 60s and 70s. He then broke through with Elvis and then with the Comedy Store. He never had to come back here. But there are guys like that, and these guys were all now in their 80s, and I was like 45, 46 years old. So I was getting all their work, and I was doing great. And I then segued onto cruise ships, which I don't do the mass market ones because I had to become such a fuddy-duddy on stage with clean and not doing offensive humor that now I'm really like a comedian for senior citizens. And there are these cruise lines, these luxury cruise lines that are just that. They're very elderly people, very wealthy, very upscale. And so in a nutshell, I'm sorry to
I have some questions about this, but go ahead.
But in a nutshell, I went from trying to get out of show business and to open like a coin-operated laundry or a yogurt stand. Now I make more money than I've ever made in my life. I can work I can work probably about 20 plus weeks on these ships, which is another thing. It'll drive you insane, but yes, you can. I think Osama bin Laden must have worked on a cruise ship because if you see that picture of him from 1972 with his family, they're all hip in front of that Volkswagen van. He's wearing like psychedelic clothing. They may have sent him on like Carnival, and then the rest is history, right? Could have happened, but...
Can I ask you a couple questions about this?
I'm going to finish, though. I want to finish, and then I do the condominiums down here. And so it's this amazing career that I've got. I'm like a big shot down here, but nobody knows it. That's it. All right. Now you ask me your questions.
There is a condo circuit.
Yes, there is.
In Florida. And as I understand it, they have showrooms that a lot of elderly people retire to Florida. And one of the selling points is the condo has a state-of-the-art auditorium for lectures and shows. And is that how it works down there?
100% correct. They have, again, this goes to that homogeneous thing. These are predominantly Jewish. Now, over the years, there's Italian-Americans, some Irish-Americans, and some people of just other that are moving into these condos. But when they were set up in the late 60s, mid-70s, it was strictly, a lot of them were union people, like teachers' unions. They all went into one development. So it was so exact. And as you know, Jews love live entertainment other than other ethnic groups, way more so. And it goes back to living in the shtetls, in the Pale of Settlement in the 1800s, where you lived away from all the other people and you had to entertain yourself. And a guy would get up with a fiddle, hence Fiddler on the Roof. And someone would get up and sing. And someone would get up and tell stories, funny, humorous stories, or do like imitations of, you know, people in the town or in the village, and hence the stand-up comedian. This is what I've read and been told. I'm not 100% on this, but this makes a lot of sense. So it was in the Jewish culture, and it carried on, of course, through the Catskills and vaudeville and the whole deal. So yes,
but there was also the Italian Alps, right? Pat Cooper started there.
But I'm saying with Jews, it might be 90% their love of entertainment, but when it drops off to the other ethnics. I say the Italians are way up there, but not as much as you see. The Jews don't drink, so they compensate the not drinking with the entertainment, and that's why you're laughing. This is what I've had to learn. Like a country club, take Country Club X in New Jersey, 25 miles from New York, like Edge, I think it's called that, whatever, big Jewish country club. That we'll call that X. Mm-hmm. And then we'll have Y, which is the non-Jewish country club. Y never has shows. X has like 10 shows a year. Now, why is that? Because people who join a country club have what's called a minimum. You've got to pay $2,000 out of pocket every year to eat in the restaurant or to drink in the restaurant at the country club. The non-Jewish people have no problem meeting their minimums because they drink. So the drinks are expensive. They drink, and the next thing you know, the minimum is done. A Jew doesn't drink, so a Jew goes, I'm on a diet, I'll just have soup, and they start the whole nonsense, and by the end of the year, they still owe $1,995. So they go, this is a predicament because I got to give money for nothing. So then they call Agent Q. Agent Q puts a show into Country Club X, and they eat up their food minimum. And then what happens is the Jewish person calls up people that they're friends with that don't belong to the country club because they got to burn off the thing. So come to our show. You'll come as my guests, and you'll take me to your place, or you'll take me out to dinner in reciprocity. And this is how it happens. It's all done to burn off food minimums. And the Gentiles, meanwhile, go, not only have I spent my $2,000, I spent an extra $1,000, and they're just as happy. They're happier than the Jews, but this is what goes on. It's a funny bit. I just made it up with attachments to Jack Mason and every other Jewish comedian in my head of me. But yes, that's what goes on down there. It's a madhouse.
The condo circuit, it's show business.
It's real show business. It's ending as we speak. When I came here in 03, all I heard, and I had a zillion gigs, all I heard was, you should have been here 30 years ago when, blah, blah, blah. Well, I wasn't. I heard stories about it. It was amazing. And now it is this development that I live in. I live in an over 55 community. We've had a lot of vacancies here, I guess, the past 2 years. And everyone that's moved in is not Jewish. And now they're starting to, I'd say about 30 of these people in a community of 250 are saying, why do we have this entertainment budget? I see that we're having comedians and they're from another culture. Mm-hmm. And they just don't understand why they have to pay, their monthly maintenance, why a segment of that goes for entertainment. So more and more, this may filter out. Maybe they'll have two shows a year as opposed to seven.
Explain to my listeners what Florida is to New York, because we have people hearing this show all over the world. The New York metropolitan area connection to Florida?
Well, first, the connection of Florida, period, is that there's no state income tax. Real estate is very reasonable. And, it's a tropical climate once you hit South Florida. So it's really less traffic than congested parts of the country. It's a great place to live. And you've got millions of miles of beaches down here. There's a lot of pluses if you like to work out all that stuff. So originally, before air conditioning, it was not that desirable. But of course, we're talking probably about 50 plus years of air conditioning now. It's a great haven. And of course, people from New York have predominantly moved to South Florida areas because, again, Jews are clannish people. New Yorkers, non-Jewish New Yorkers, are clannish people. So there's pockets down here where Italian Americans live en masse, like a Pompano Beach, Florida, which is near Fort Lauderdale. And of course, Palm Beach, Florida, where, you know, the country club WASPY crowd goes there. So everyone has found their little pockets down here. But of course, you know, New York congestion, traffic, it has a lot of the elements that as you get older, you just have that, I can't deal with this anymore attitude. You want a different way of life. Plus, you don't want to shovel snow or get stuck in inclement weather. So hence, people coming here. Now you've got other areas of Florida, the west coast of Florida. You have people from the Midwest, Ohio and Michigan, and you know, again, urban areas where they don't want to fight anymore. As you get older, a man loses his testosterone and, you know, enough of the banging your head against the wall. And Florida is a great retirement community. Like I said, cheap real estate and no state income tax. So
and you could work all the time. Now.
No. I only can work interesting here for any comedians or show business people listening. The season as it is only, you know, for the shows about December 21st to March 15th, let's say. And then a good 3/4 of the New Yorkers that live here go back east. They go back home, excuse me, go back north. And then so the shows all end. So there are some places that do very low budget shows during the summer, but it's few and far between. So it's a very intense thing. In South Florida, during the winter, you have some of the best shows in the United States. I say it goes toe to toe with Las Vegas. You can have Clint Holmes, you have Tony Orlando, people who are names, but were names a long time ago, but still fantastic entertainers. Steve Solomon, who's got a current one-man show. The comedy that goes on down here rivals Las Vegas. However, the weird thing, David, is that every community here is private. So no one who lives in the public, you know, lives like in a, just in a condo on the beach can ever see any of these shows because they are not a member of the country club or not a member of the gated community. So that's the irony with so much entertainment in the winter, but no one can see it unless they live in that particular community.
And how many people in the showroom?
Some of the showrooms are 300 to 1,100.
Wow.
They are some of the theaters are so phenomenal. I'll give you case in point to some of the grand, like Century Village. There's 4 Century Villages, and they have entertainment. Or there's 3 Century Villages. I'm blanking for a second. But anyway, they have stages that if you just dropped Bruce Springsteen or Frank Sinatra onto the stage, they wouldn't know where they were, and they'd go, hey, this place is great. That's how incredible they are.
And everybody in the audience is over the age of?
Well, Century Village, they can be in their 90s. They can be 95. There's a place down here called Forest Trace, and my dear friend, Jenny Grossinger Edis, she's the daughter, Elaine Edis, who is the daughter of sure. Jenny Grossinger. She was on the board of this Forest Trace, getting the entertainment and
tell
lending
what
the
Grossinger's was.
Grossinger's was numero uno hotel in the Catskill Mountains during the heyday, which would have been the late 40s. Through the 50s, into the 60s, into the 70s, and produced some of the great. I mean, I wish I had the PR here. I mean, everyone who was anyone, the greatest of the greatest, you know, had their feet. Even Woody Allen, when you read read his interviews, he would go to these hotels on summer staff, and they would do a show because the audience was different. Some of the audience was the same all summer. They had to produce a show using all the staff, the waiters and everything. And Woody Allen would write a 25-minute show or longer every week. Then he would direct it. They would have rehearsals, all while these kids who were there were waiters, lifeguards, you know, tennis instructors. They all lived for the night to rehearse these shows, and then they would perform these shows on Saturday. And that's what gave him, you know, all that, how he was so profound. And Mel Brooks did this too. This is why these people were so many light years
ahead. Granddaughter Edis?
No, Elaine Edis is the daughter of Jenny Grossinger, and Jenny Grossinger, I believe, is the, that was the, you know, they would probably, that her mom was probably born, let's say 19 oh something or other, and then Elaine came along.
Is she married to a doctor?
I believe so, yes.
Is he a psychiatrist?
Well, he's passed away, but I believe so.
But if you're a psychiatrist, you can still practice.
No, I think he passed away as well.
No, I'm saying if you're a dead psychiatrist, you can go a couple of years.
I guess as long as the clock, the alarm goes at 50 mm-hmm. minutes, yes, you know when to get rid of the patient. And she actually lives down here. She's such a sweet woman. I wish I had known her all those years prior, but I was not a Catskill comedian. But yes, the show, Elaine Edis was booking the entertainment for a place called Forest Trace. Now, Forest Trace, we were talking about ages. Forest Trace, I had people in their late 90s and into their hundreds. It wasn't what's called assisted living, but it was just on the cusp of, these were people who were still lucid enough and but were not living in assisted living. And I asked, who's married the longest? How many years do you think some of these people were married in the audience? Well, it's a trick question. And the answer is like 3 and 4, because these were people who all outlived their spouses. There were no one to came there together. And they had children. I was talking to a 102-year-old man who had an 83-year-old daughter living at Century Village. I'm going, oh my God. Oh my God. What has it come to? Where have I gone in life? This is, what am I being punished for? I know what I'm being punished for. I'm being punished for everything. But and they nod off. You know, half the room just goes down like a robot when you take pull the plug out. And the other side comes up. And then that side goes down. It's like a wave. And the other side, you plug the robot back into the wall. And nothing gets accomplished. You just, as good as I am, nothing gets accomplished there. It's just, you know, it's nothing's accomplished.
That's, well, how do you measure a laugh?
You can't there. You see, there are exceptions. And I'm just giving, you know, I'm giving you the extreme of what it's like down here. But no, these condos, I kill them. I look at people, I insult them. I say the meanest things to them because they love me. They know me. And I'm like their, impetuous? I'm like their impetuous kid. I'm like Eddie Haskell. They can't wait for me to say something really mean because they know it's almost, God bless them, almost at a Rickles level, you know, mm-hmm. but I mean, not as violent of things that I say, but like, you know, but insulting nonetheless. Yes. So it's, I've got this little thing carved down, another comic, you know, Sarge, you know who he is?
No.
He's a black guy who was adopted by, like, right out of the womb by Jews. So he's a Jew. You got to look him up. He's very interesting. He was in L.A., didn't really accomplish much in L.A., but he found his niche.
Wait a second. Hang on for 1 second.
Yeah.
Okay. As I understand the Catskills, this is what my father's friends used to tell me.
Right.
The showstopper at Grossinger's was the African-American who came out and sang My Yiddish Mama.
Probably, but I know Johnny Yoon used to do that. You remember him, the Korean guy?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
He used to do My Yiddish Mama, and they fall down.
Jews think it's the funniest thing in the world.
They love it to hear
somebody who isn't white singing My Yiddish Mama.
You know what's funny down here at these condos is they have the other type of ethnicity that works really well here are Italian Americans, because like Sal Richards is great, mm-hmm. and he's comic and he sings, and they love Italian singers.
And they're angry.
So they love the Pat Coopers. I call these comics the Huff and Puffers, because if you wrote down what they're saying as a writer, and you're such a phenomenal writer, you would not see anything intrinsically funny. You just see, and my wife, that fat, blah, 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 she, my kid, he's another one, that stupid moron, and I go, I'm not finding anything funny here. But they go ring, ring, and they huff and they puff, and the next thing you know, the audience is splitting their sides. I'm going, I don't see the joke. I see the audience bending over. I see, you know, I see comedy on the script. I see it on the page. And when I hear the huff and puffers, I'm so jealous of them because they're not. I sit over a joke. I don't tell a joke for 9 years until I think it's right. And then it bombs and it's no good. It was mm-hmm. never good to begin with. But these huff and puffers, and I go to McDonald's. Who's that idiot? Screaming. I'm going, where's that funny? Who's that idiot? Let me write that down. Who's that idiot. That
it's
is not,
music. It's music. You're paying attention to the lyrics, and the audience is.
It's like Robert Klein. He's my idol. He's a lot of these our generation idol, and if I meet him, I've met him twice. He's not the nicest guy in the world. I got to be honest with you. I can't say I've had a nice time meeting
him.
I've met a lot.
Me neither.
But I want to corner him and go, here's the conundrum, Robert. We all started because we idolized you, but you're a false idol because there's nothing to copy. He can't be copied. He's like, he was an actor who was able to do stand-up, who's a singer, who's can write. He has every tool. You know, in baseball, there's the tool player. He's an 80. 80 is the high end of the graph. He's a five-tool comedian. He can write. He can sing. He can act. He can. He doesn't do traditional punchline. He's amazing. So all these comics like myself and all these other guys that are way inferior that he'll ever be, we watched that and went, oh, I can do this. And you know what? No, I can't. I'm doing this 43 years. I can't do it. He's one of a kind. Yeah. And yet he started all of us. So it was this false thing because you can't be like him. If I watched the guys on Ed Sullivan, I used to watch those guys and go, ah, they're corny. And I never wanted to be like them. Well, that's what I became. Run of the mill, funny, but cornball. And if I had known that this is what I would have, my value early on, I wouldn't have done this. You remember, there's guys like Eric Gold. You remember Eric Gold? You know who he is, huge producer. Mm-hmm. He started like as a comic, then he became an agent, and then he became this gigantic, you know, Jim Carrey, the Wayans brothers, him and Jimmy Miller's, Dennis Miller's brother, Jimmy. So these guys recognized whatever they recognized, and you know, they're so wealthy now, I don't even know if they exist. They're on another dimension.
Right, right.
So, yeah. So I don't know where we go off on these things.
I'm just curious. One final question about the condo circuit.
Yeah, sure.
It's only 3 or 4 months a year.
That's it. Yeah.
And then what do the old people do with that auditorium?
Well, they don't do anything. You know, I mean, they have lectures. They really do. They show movies in it. It's not that it's not used, but it's not. They can't generate money, so they're not going to have a show. They may have a low budget show. Like I said, maybe at Century Village they'll have one low budget show a week, which is, you know, like a singer comes out and plays to tracks, and it's a very good singer, but there's no band.
Right.
So that is affordable. Or I'd like to say a comedian, but there are no comedians that can tackle these audiences anymore. And so you have to be really good to even begin to tackle them. So an inferior comedian doesn't even exist anymore. So it's really like someone will come out and sing, or someone will play the piano. And, you know, and the audiences are only like a third filled because so many people go up north for the winter.
Well, you're in Delray Beach, Florida. How far is that from Miami?
About 38 miles from Miami.
So I would assume there's a community of comics that hangs out at Wolfie's. Is there a deli?
Oh, no, that all closed. And the community of comedians, there's the Jerry Grant, who was an agent here in 1950. And Jerry is still around. I think he's 88 years old. And they have what's called the Lunch Bunch. And the guys like Vic Arnell of that era. Vic is younger. Dick Capri. Do you know that name?
Dick Capri was the first night I did comedy. Dick Capri was still at Dangerfields.
Yeah. It looks great. Funny, nice man. Freddie Roman is here. And this guy, Stewie Stone, who I don't know. He just moved down here.
I know Stewie.
He's from the Friars in New York. And Lonnie Shore, who's a Jewish comedian, but grew up in North Carolina and toured with Kenny Rogers and Dolly Parton. So he went another way with his comedy, and he lives down here. And occasionally they get together. And Will Schreiner is down here, and Will hangs out, and Richie Minervini from the East Side Comedy Club, and he now books the Borgata. He lives down here. And Sarge, like I said, lives down here. And of course, everybody's favorite, Peter Fogel. He lives 1 mile from me. I can't get away from him.
Did Peter Fogel get a degree in history? Is he a professor?
No.
Okay, I'm thinking of somebody else. All right. So for those of you who don't know who Bruce Smirnoff is, everybody in comedy, especially in LA, loves Bruce Smirnoff.
Oh, thank you.
They do. And they think you're the funniest guy in the world, and you have had every opportunity.
I did. I had a lot of opportunities.
Every opportunity to hit it big, because the minute you came on the scene, you were iconic. People knew who you were, what you were, because of the way you look, the way you talk, rhythms. You are a naturally funny human being.
Yes, but I didn't have that at first. Here's the problem. And my work ethic was terrible. And any comedians who listen to the show, it's all about work. Look at Jerry Seinfeld. This is a man who is a robot. He just, whether he produces anything or not, he sits and he writes for hours a day, and a work ethic like you cannot believe. And I believe he has a very marvelous career to show from it. However, me, gifted, naturally funny guy, can crack up a dead body, but I was too busy chasing women, maybe smoking a little pot, and doing everything but doing the work, and expecting everything. And interestingly, I moved to LA. I wasn't good when I moved to LA. I was too premature. I went there because I had stars in my eyes with nothing to show for it. But because I had such a great look, everybody came in to see me, and I stunk. And everyone pronounced me ice cold. And when you get pronounced bad and ice cold in Los Angeles, it may take, 800 or 900 years to get to come full circle. And I just don't have that much time. So, yes, I wrote that show. That
right, what was the, now? Let me. One of the happiest nights of my life was in Las Vegas with my son and Todd Glass and Avi, and hanging out with you after the show. And another happiest night of my life was taking my father to see your one-man show. About 20 years ago, there was this phenomenon of comedians doing one-man shows.
Yes.
Rick Reynolds, Rob Becker.
Jackie Mason had one of the best ones. And that woman, it's Pat. I'm blanking on her name.
Yeah.
She had one. Yes.
And you had
everybody and his mother.
And you had a one-man show.
Right.
About failure.
All my failures. Yes.
All your failures.
My failures, I went my whole career, going on the road and telling comics at a Dunkin' Donuts or wherever we were about these terrible things that happened to me. And I never knew they were gross stories, meaning that heavy duty of an amazing story, because I was just led to believe from all my teachers in acting school and everything, they tell you you're going to have failure. So I just assumed that my failures were just run-of-the-mill failures. But I would tell people these stories and mouths would drop open. Mm-hmm. People would go, you've got to do this as a story. So finally, remember Richard Baker, Rick Messina's partner, Richard Baker and Rick Messina, Tim Allen, John Mulrooney, some of the great, Janine Garofalo, biggest names in comedy. They're producer managers. They told me you have to do this. So I put it together. I went to Mark Travis, who had produced or helped direct and directed The Bronx Tale with Chaz Palminteri. I took his class and I put all these stories together. And I came up with my show called Other Than My Health, I Have Nothing. And today I don't feel so good. And where my act was always trying to please others, this one-man show, I didn't give a hoot about anybody. I just cared about being inside, hip, telling it and exposing these stars in ways that no one can believe. But
okay.
These were all true stories.
They were all true stories. There was a time when I saw Borat. And when I was watching Borat, I remember, I turned to my wife about 10 minutes in, I go, I cannot laugh this hard anymore.
My kishkas were killing me. My guts were.
And all the way through. I'm not going to be able, I'm going to get sick. He's killing me.
Yes,
I saw your one-man show three times.
Yeah.
And I took my father, and every time I went to see it, I laughed harder. And I, people who listen to this show know that I've said this, that of all the one-man shows, you weren't trying to teach me anything. No. You weren't trying to prove a point. Nope. You were just telling us the truth about your career. You had brushes with greatness.
The greatness.
Johnny Carson, Carol O'Connor.
And stories I can't tell until these people pass away. I gotta keep it on the QT.
Well, Johnny Carson died, and he was alive when you told that story about driving him home drunk.
Right, but the story that I can't tell is about somebody's wife, and she passed away, and it's not nice. And when I say an icon, it's like hardcore. I mean, even bigger than Johnny Carson. I can't go there right now. So,
but you tell this great.
But it's in such bad light. You know, I caught stars like having a bad day. It's like taking somebody to the beach and he accidentally walked them into a landmine. And you go, I'll see you later. And you go, I better not step. Boom. Or I'll go over here. Bang. And I caught like Carol O'Connor on his worst day, Johnny Carson on his worst day, X, who I can't talk about now, in a bad situation. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The story I remember, this is because we had talked about Carson with, who was it? Larry Brown was on the show on Tuesday, and we were talking about getting on the Carson show, and Jim McCauley, who booked the Carson show, courting Larry to come on and do 5 minutes and getting the set ready. And we were trying to explain to the young audience what it meant to do Carson in the 80s. It was everything. It was the difference between being an open micer and headlining Vegas.
It was life or death. It was it. It was, you know, there wasn't Letterman. There wasn't anything that was a launching pad except for Ed Sullivan. And then Carson inherited that throne. And that was it.
And you great story. I'm not going to ask you to tell it, but there's this great story that you tell in your show about the night Johnny Carson came in to the improv.
And he
was in the improv and into his cups, and somehow he ended up seeing you. This is how I remember it. It's been
right, but remember the multi-level on it. It because it's involved my agent at the time and his son. So this was like three cars colliding on a corner while I'm crossing the street going, hey, that car's gonna hit, hey, that car's gonna, oh no, that truck's coming out. And it was like three things all amalgamated. Cause when I did that story.
Was this Danny Robinson?
Bud Robinson. It's a Bud Robinson, a Bud Friedman, Irvin Arthur's son, Adam Arthur, the drug addict, and Johnny Carson. And it was a collision, and so when I tell a story, you know, you want to tell a story with the beginning, a middle, and end. This has a beginning tangent, middle, another tangent, end, two tangents. So it was very difficult to construct it because I had to tell it real because it's so unbelievable that it's believable. So I had to bring it. So it was a folly of horror all going on with Carson. Remember, I have to drive the guy home at the end of the night and he's with a girl and he's married and he's just been arrested, you know, 5 days earlier. And, you know, do you remember when he got arrested for drunk driving? This shows you how Mothers Against Drunk Driving, how that has progressed since 1982, when he came on the show. He got arrested, I think, on a Sunday night, and then he didn't go on the Tonight Show for a week. I believe that's how it went. And then when he came out the following Monday to do his monologue, do you remember how he came out on stage? He came out in handcuffs with two LAPD officers walking him out onto the stage. And the audience, the guy was arrested for drunk driving where you kill people. And the audience is going, hey-o, hey-o, hey-o. And the cops, you know, turn him around and they undo the handcuffs and he does the, you know, when you shake your wrists, when you rub your hands on the wrist, and he waved goodbye to the cops. And that, and now this is like, you know, and this is, I'm in the middle of all this, you know? Yeah. Yeah.
So this was 1982?
I believe, yeah.
82. Yeah. He was at the height. He had just beaten Fred Silverman. Fred Silverman was the head of NBC, and Silverman said, Johnny has to go to work. He's not working hard enough. And Johnny said, yeah, I quit. It's either you or me. And they got rid of Fred Silverman, who was the golden boy. The golden boy of TV. And Johnny made this amazing deal where he owned all the Tonight Shows. And then they gave him everything. And he was at the height in 82. So he came into the improv. How did you get on stage that night?
He came into the improv drunk. I mean, if you want to go through the story, this was still during that Bender period. So this is before the hey-o with the handcuffs. He was in a bad, bad way. Oh, do I have inside stuff? I cannot tell you because it's just, but I've got deeper stuff. But anyway, he's drunk. And he's never been to the improv. He's been to the one in New York.
Let me interrupt you for 1 second.
Yeah.
Letterman gave an interview. And I was surprised. I saw an interview with Letterman right after Johnny died saying that Johnny brought the boat to the Hudson River and called Dave. He had been retired and he called Dave. He said, after your show, come by the Hudson River. We'll cruise around the island.
Okay.
And Dave says yes. And it's very striking. Letterman, who would not say a bad thing about Johnny Carson, in the interview, did not intimate this. He said the clock was ticking because Johnny started to drink. And I was on the boat with Johnny and his wife. Yeah. And I was watching the cups. Once I knew, this is what Letterman said. Once we get past two cups, it's time to get off the boat because you don't want to be around Johnny when he's drunk.
Correct.
So, I mean, he was a legend.
But I didn't know that. And I'm like just an idiot at the improv. I'm 20-something years old. And he goes to the bar. And first of all, let me set it up. The people at the bar, Hollywood, Los Angeles, California, improv, you got people sitting in the restaurant that are having dinner, whatever, they're going to go into the showroom. But the people at the bar are the lifers, actors, out of work, everything, that come in, have a drink. It's a very kinship. It's almost like a Cheers type of situation. Mm-hmm. So they're nonplussed. Anybody comes in, oh, look, over there, Robin Williams. Nobody even moves their head, just their eyeballs. Over there, Robin Williams. Nothing. When Johnny walked into that bar, that even the non-plus people, everyone, listen to this, they stood on a Saturday night. People stood and gave him a standing ovation, not in the showroom, in the bar. And in the restaurant, people just got up from their chairs because they knew the gravitas of Johnny Carson coming to a comedy club to discover a comedian who's going to change his life for the better, hopefully. So they... Wow. And he walks through this maze of people applauding because he doesn't care. He's drunk. He's a drunky poo. He's not Johnny Carson. He's a stew bum. And he goes to the bar and he gets three shots of Jack Daniels. Eddie, the bartender, poured him three shots of Jack
Daniels. Eddie.
Yeah. And that's why I can't ever get sued I never got sued because I had witnesses. I got Sandy shot. I got witnesses. Nobody can. These really happened to me. So he drinks those shots, whoosh, whoosh, whoosh. And I'm like 5 feet from him because I want to be weird. I want to smell him. I want to go. He was not a short guy. I'm 6'3", so everybody's short to me, but he was like 6 feet tall. He had a big, broad shoulders. He was an athlete, you know? And so he walks by, goes into the showroom, and it's like, I get on Saturday nights, but I go on 5 minutes to two. That's always my spot back then, you know, and sometimes I'd go on after Robin Williams. So I'd have like three people that were making out, all three of them with each other. And that would be my audience. But I knew that that's accepted. That's how it works.
And you were new. You were new.
Relatively, yes. And this is what happens. So he goes into the showroom and I go, man, whoever's on stage, they have no idea they're going to be seen. It was Paul Provenza, by the way, and he did get the Tonight Show. They're going to be seen by Johnny Carson. And no sooner than I thought that thought, Bud Friedman comes running up to me, the owner of the improv, and he goes, Brucey, I just got a phone call. Two guys are going to be late. One canceled. You're on next. And it was like, oh. I had no time. I couldn't even get nervous because you just had no time. So Bud runs onto the stage, takes off Paul Provenza, and brings me on. Please welcome a young man who will steal your hearts from my home state of Connecticut, Bruce Smirnoff. And I go on stage, And I, you know, I got my opening joke and it does great because the audience knows he's there. It's like, it's a wink, wink. Everyone is going to help everyone. It's like the brotherhood in action. And I do my second joke. It does better than my first. And I do my third joke. It's better than my second. I'm on a build. And I do my fourth joke and somebody in the audience yells out, "Stolen. You stink. Get off." Oh my God, I'm being heckled. And I look to see, I'm panicked, and I look to see, and it's my agent's son. It's terrible. We're laughing. It's the worst thing that could possibly happen. And we're not even started yet. It has its stories just going. He's there with a like the Coke sniffles and empty beer bottles in his table, and I go, "Adam, what are you doing?" He goes, "I don't know why my father handles you. We're having a private conversation in a full house with Johnny Carson sitting there. It's the worst thing that could happen." And he's going, "You stink. I don't know why my father handles you." And I couldn't, and then my voice went like this. I couldn't talk. And the schwitzing, the sweat. If I had a bar of soap, all I could have just lathered up. It was, and I just, in what seemed, you know, hours, but it was probably about 40 seconds. I was just a deer. Bud comes running up and he just kind of pushes me off to the side and I hand him the microphone and I just walk off the stage. Now, that's a bad story, but that's just the beginning.
I completely forgot this.
Oh my God. I haven't told this story in a long time anyway. Your listeners, I'll tell you what, my friend, you know, Bob Golub.
Yeah, Bob. I want to hear the story. So as I remember it, hang on. I
have a video of the show.
I know, so but hang on for one second. I don't remember being heckled by the agent's son.
Oh, that's
this is how I, this is, I haven't seen this in 20 years. As I remember it, you don't drink.
I don't drink.
And you have a car.
Okay, all right. Hey, well, first I run out to the street because I don't know what to do. This is like DEFCON 5. And I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. And I walk up and down Melrose, and then I go, I got to face reality. You have to face this. You can't run. You're gonna run out of roads eventually. So I come back. As I'm coming back into the improv, they had thrown Adam Arthur out of the club. As I'm walking back, he's getting into his Jeep. And he gives me the finger. And he almost runs my foot over. I can't believe this is all happening. So now I have the worst thing, and I've almost lost my left foot. So I can't even react to that. And I go into the club, and as soon as I open up the front door to the club, Bud Robinson, not to be confused with Bud Friedman, Bud Robinson is a very great man who handled Doc Severinsen and other great comedians like Will Schreiner, Rick Bodell, Johnny Dark. He is best friends with Johnny Carson because he used to be his opening act when he was a dance team with his wife. And he, you know, is just Johnny's dearest friend. So he comes running over to me and goes, "Bruce, you're the only responsible person we know here. Johnny's too drunk to drive home. You're going to have to drive him home." So we've got bombing, walking on Melrose, not knowing what to do, almost getting my left foot amputated by this idiot, the same guy who heckled me. Wow. And now I'm giving the keys to Johnny Carson's car. I got to drive him home.
Oh, wait a second. Hang on for one second. So yeah, there's an opportunity for redemption.
Exactly.
You, can, go, you get in the car with Johnny and you can smooth things up, right?
Exactly. So now we fast forward. I'm driving this car, this Mercedes, and I'm looking into, he's in the back seat. However, what we forget to tell is that in the front row of the show, and I still remember, were these four girls or two girls from Chicago. They must have been like 18 and they were so hot. Well, guess what? One of them is in the back seat now and making out with Johnny Carson. And I'm going, this is, he was just arrested. So I'm going, I'm on the Santa Monica, I'm on the 405, I'm going 8 miles an hour. I don't want any problems. I don't want any, I think I'm going 32 miles an hour. And I keep looking in the rearview mirror because I told Sandy Shire to follow me in my car so that I have a ride home once I drop him off. And every so often, the girl stops making out with Johnny, and she sees my eyes in the rearview mirror, and she gives him like a little rib. Hold on a second. I got to let this person in. Ken, I'm on a podcast. Are you coming by? Yeah. All right. Just beep, then I'll beep you in. How do you like that? You get a phone call while I'm on a podcast. So anyway, so the girl jabs him in the ribs and goes, "Johnny, he's funny. You ought to put him on your show." And he looked, and I go, "Johnny, Bruce Smirnoff, at your service." And he leans forward and he goes, "Let me tell you something. You got no timing. You don't know what you're doing. You stink." And I go, "Thank you very much. And I'm going to get you home as safely as possible." So, and he's back to making out with her. So then we get to the house. It's just so horrible. So bad. He lived in, he had a few homes. This was his Malibu house. And he had like it looked like 13-foot gate with a turret. A turret? Who has a turret? With a guy with a shotgun in the turret. I guess you have to have that, you know. And two iron gates. So I come with the car, and they open up. Another guard comes down, opens up the gate. And like in The Godfather, remember they were the Godfather 2 with when De Niro goes to kill the guy who killed his father. They open up the gate to Don, whatever that guy's. Anyway, mm-hmm. Don Vito, whatever the guy. So I pull into his driveway. He's got a big circular driveway. I pull in and I get out of my car and I go to open the door, the back seat, to get the two of them out. But what happens is he's in a lockdown on this chick. He's like dry humping her because he doesn't want her to get, you know, hinky and want to go home. So he's applying the pressure. Meanwhile, all the lights to his mansion come flooding on because his help has all been sleeping. And they're realizing, oh my God, he's having a party. So the lights come on. And then I look, my car comes in behind, you know, my Johnny's car with Sandy at the wheel. And what's the most amazing thing is another car. And another car, and another, about seven cars. All these drunks and barflies that I told you before that hang out at the Improv, they all just figured, hey, party at Carson's house. Complete strangers walking around his property. The staff are half-dressed, coming, running out. He's having a party. He's having a party. Who's going to have drinks? I'm having a party, party. And he doesn't see any of this because he's dry humping her six in the back of the car here, you know? So finally he gets off and he just gets out of the car and he sees his staff at attention. He sees all these guys like hanging on their bumpers. Hey, hey, Johnny. Hi, Johnny. And he just looks at me and goes, what are these people doing here? I go, here's what I know so far. I told to follow me. I guess he may have told that guy who in turn, get the hell out of here before I have you arrested. And I go, Johnny, they're as good as gone. And I got everybody out. And that's my, and then of course on Monday I call Irvin Arthur, the agent whose son had created all this mess. And I told him what his son had did. And he apologized. He said, I profusely apologize. My son is become a junkie. He's addicted to drugs and he had a fight with me. And I guess this was his way of getting back at all of my clients. I so apologize. And he apologized profusely. And a week later, he dropped me as a client because every time he thought of me, I reminded him of his drug addict son. So that was the end of that. I lost on about 19 different levels in that story. Oh, is that a bad story? What a horrible, horrible night. And you're lucky I didn't swear the whole time. That's just a horrible thing. But what I wanted to tell your listeners is Bob Golub, I have a video of this show on one of the great nights. And we put it up on YouTube. And it's I forget how you find it. But if you put my name, Bruce Smirnoff, and then you put one man show, I believe it will take you to it. And you'll see these stories. It's really funny. You don't have to pay for it.
Yeah.
Enjoy it. Now, I've done this show. A couple of producers here in Florida felt that this would be, it got me a deal, pretty much close to a deal with CBS. It was not a done deal. And it got me in the front page of the Los Angeles Thursday calendar. So I had a lot of gravitas from this, but nothing happened. And then Larry David, of course, came along and, you know, the rest is history. He's phenomenal. And his pedigree is beyond.
Yeah, but this is completely different from Larry David.
It's completely different. It's very similar because my idea for a sitcom was based loosely on that, you know, all my comedian friends and having normal friends and always screwing up my, I mean, it reads like a blueprint. So anyhow, wrong place, wrong time.
But we have to wrap it up and you'll come back. And this has been so much fun. I think the Johnny Carson story should be recreated for film.
Well, it was. I have the script, but there's no use to do it because Larry David does everything. You know.
No, I'm saying is have somebody play Johnny Carson, have somebody play Erin Arthur's kid.
Sure. It's very funny. Yes, it's because it's on so many different levels. It's three dimensional chess. It's coming at you. You know, not like I said, a three way accident. You know. Yes.
I will say this about the YouTube video.
Yes.
There's no way it can capture.
It does. It's really good. It really it was so many people in the theater, I had to put people on the stage. Mm-hmm. So you actually see people sitting on the stage, and I'm talking to them while I'm talking to the audience.
You know what I remember? I don't want to give it away, but I remember it opens with... The Triumph of the Whales. It was some Nazi.
No. That's in the middle. That's when I describe the hardest gig, which is when you do these Jewish events around the country. They always put a Holocaust video on to suck money from the audience, and then they bring a comedian on, and they do this to everybody. But I was the first comic to actually be able to articulate it and show it and demonstrate. I didn't show it visually. I showed it audibly, whatever the word is.
Yeah.
Where I reenacted it I made that audio tape of the whole thing. And that is, yes, on the video. You can watch that. So, it's all so funny.
So before you go, I'm going to make Bruce Smirnoff laugh with a brief... true story, and the audience is just going to have to suffer through this.
Okay.
I'm making you laugh.
Suffer.
Okay. I'm at my dermatologist's, and I sign in. This was about 10 years ago.
Okay.
And Cedars-Sinai, Beverly Hills.
Oh, what's his name? Yeah.
And I'm checking into my dermatologist, yes. And I see a list of names. And about an hour before, I see Billy Rebeck. Hang on. Did I ever tell you this?
No, but anything with dermatologist and Billy Rebeck, it's already, you know, it's Donald Trump and a model story. It's going to be funny, you know.
So, he's a very straight, down the middle dermatologist.
I went to him. He's a great guy. Yeah. I remember. Dr. Oh, God. Anyway, whatever.
So I said, I noticed Billy Rebeck is is here for a mole check. He said, he's gone. He left a long time ago. I said, really? I would assume you need a hedge clipper.
Yes.
To find... You know, before you can get to the moles, you have to just do the entire hedge clipper.
Billy Rebeck is cousin it, period, with a great sense of humor, a brilliant writer. But it's cousin it. He's covered from head to the end of his toenails. He has hair on his second knuckle. If you look at your hand, men, you have hair on your first knuckle. Very few have second. He has like a Mo Howard haircut on his second knuckle. He's an ape. And he has every product that known to mankind. He has ass buff number 6. He has eye polish. He has everything that Estee Lauder hasn't even invented. They test things out on him. He has like 7 deep in cologne when you go to his condo. He has cologne for the last 8 years just in one bottle, and it's backed up by 7 extras. And he has 27 different kinds of cologne. And he has Estee Lauder ass buff 1, ass buff 2, coloration number 9, this, that, you know, feet smell, feet de-stink. Number 16, every possible thing he's got. There isn't a cologne, a cosmetic thing that is. He has masks on top of masks. He has masks to put on a Halloween mask. He's one of the funniest characters in life. And when you put him and me in a room together and we start insulting each other, they say people would pay money to watch us go at it. You know, I just given you a sample, but then he attacks me and I'm very, very, very valuable asset too. So the two of us ripping each other to shreds, people, the tears coming out, and it's very funny. You should Google Billy Reback, everyone, R-I-B-A-C-K. Another one with an amazing career. And
you Google Billy Reback, it says, see body hair.
Cousin.
How do people follow you? How do people follow you and stay in touch with you?
You don't. I mean, I don't have a website. My email is brucevodka@yahoo.com if you want to ask me a question, because I have nothing to do. I love to kibitz with people. You can certainly email me, and I love to go back and forth.
Do you tweet?
I tweet, but I'm very political. It will turn off a lot of people. So don't go to my Twitter. just I'm on Facebook. You can do my Facebook. That'll turn a lot of people off. Just email me. You want a Donald Trump story before we go? Or we don't have time.
I could talk to you forever. Before you do the Donald Trump story.
Yes.
You have to be my Florida correspondent for this show.
Sure. Anytime.
You have to cover Florida. You have to tell me what's going on. Maybe the entertainment scene in Florida.
Whatever you want.
You are amazing. You know, to call you a comedian's comedian is a disservice to you. But whenever your name comes up, we just start laughing. Whenever your name is mentioned, you are so beloved. And that one-man show, it's just hands down. Nobody says
it was great. But let me finish. Let me very quickly. So okay. We did the show down in Florida for all these senior citizens, and they all love me. And I filled the theater, 500 people. After, and I'm not making this up, after about 15 minutes, they all started to doze off. They didn't enjoy these stories. Do you know why? This show, my show worked in New York. I did it at PSNBC Studios, and I did it, of course, in LA. It was the cat's meow in New York and Hollywood. Everywhere else it's gone, it bombs. It's one of the worst shows people have ever, it's actually better than Ambien. That's how it should be advertised, because no one believes that Johnny Carson was like this. No one believes Carol O'Connor. No one believes Joan Rivers. No one believes any of these stories. So they feel as if I failed so much. They're pragmatic people who watch this show, these normal people, and they go, well, if you fail, why don't you find something else to do? They don't understand that your heart is in show business and you're going to make it no matter what. They go, look, I used to sell pennants at Yankee Stadium. Didn't do that well. I went and sold suits. I made $1 million. What's this guy? Why does he try to tell jokes so much? Then he stinks. It's not going anywhere. What's he saying? Johnny Carson. Johnny Carson doesn't drink. I watch that show every night. I saw him smoke, but I never saw him drink. What's he saying? He's drinking. This is a ripoff. I'm not coming back to this stuff. I think I'm going to sleep. Then they sleep. That was my show in Florida. Nothing. It was a failure. I mean, a complete failure. I can never bring that show back unless I did it in L.A. But again, you lose money doing it in L.A. because you have to paper the room. Anyway, what was I going to say?
Donald Trump.
Oh, Trump. Okay. So Jeffrey Ross, the great, great Jeffrey Ross, the roast master general, who's a dear friend of mine and did help me a lot also during the one-man show. He's responsible for me getting that front page calendar article on the LA Times. So I am indebted to Jeffrey forever and ever. He calls me 2002 and I'm living in New York. He goes, Donald Trump just called me. He wants me to do a gig at Mar-a-Lago. I need an opening act. Will you come? I go, yeah, sure. Now, all I knew about Donald Trump 2002, this is before The Apprentice, I just knew he was Atlantic City and divorces. I knew nothing about him. I just knew he was what he was, you know, a character. So we get to LaGuardia Airport and we're in the private terminal because we're going on his jet with him. He's not there, but Judge Jeanine is there from Fox News and a guy named David Pecker, who owns the National Enquirer. And it's like the four of us were kidding around. I'm showing Judge Jeanine my stretches that I learned in gym class. And we're having the great time. Trump comes with Melania, just his girlfriend at the time. We get on the plane and I figured, because you and I have been around a lot of Hollywood people that this conversation is going to be about 95-10. It's going to be him dominating and 5%. Maybe I'm going to get a word in. And so I'm prepared for it because I've been around these people before. We get on a plane. Trump comes in last. And Jeff goes, Donald, this is Bruce Smirnoff, a comedian. And Trump shakes my hand. He goes, Bruce, would you like to sit in the cockpit for takeoff? And I just go, you bet I would. I'm in a jump seat of a 727. This is unbelievable. I could have thrown myself on a control stick and blew up the plane. I mean, I'm in a, and this is after 9/11, and I'm in a control room. I'm in a cockpit. Well, this is unbelievable. It cured my fear of flying. Because now I know what goes on in a. It is so cool. You don't hear the engine. You don't hear anything in the cockpit. This was a 727. The engines are tail mounted, so you just. It's like nothing, and then just lift up. So anyway, I come back into the cabin. Trump go and Jeff goes, you know, Donald, Bruce has some amazing stories, and he lived in Hollywood, and I can't really tell the. He asks me a question about every kind of. It's underground that people know what happened, but it's about Sarah Silver, and because I know.
Move on. We don't.
I know. So anyway, so Trump and I and Jeff, we had the, and Melania, but Melania really was just very quiet to herself. She was quiet the whole time, and we're going back and forth with stories, and Melania just sits there, and I think she does long division, because at this time she was just a girlfriend. I think she just figured by the minute, you know, how much am I going to make if I leave this? But obviously it worked out for the best, and... but Trump was phenomenal. Obviously, this leads to me favoring him and to be able to say that I spent time. But at Mar-a-Lago, he went out of his way to hang out with Jeff and I. He's not the guy you would see ripping Rand Paul and ripping Jeb Bush. He is partly that guy. I guess that is the showman part of him. But I got to tell you, it was the greatest week. Like on the flight back, again, I sat in the cockpit for a little takeoff. But I turned to him as the plane was landing in LaGuardia. And I said, Donald, I got to be honest with you. I feel like a plumber who won to spend the weekend with Donald Trump. And it's all coming to an end and I don't like it. And I just cracked the guy up the whole weekend. So, yes. And I know politically you're not a big fan, but that is the president and that's the story.
Yeah.
And that is a pretty amazing Trump story when you think about
it. Yeah. And he basically is the closest. I'm not trying to be cute here. The closest this country has to Don Rickles in that Don address the elephant in the room, and so does Donald Trump.
Yeah, I guess, sure, absolutely.
All right. Bruce Smirnoff, thank you so much. I needed this.
I had the greatest. How long were we on? We were on like an hour and 17 minutes. Wonderful. Thank you so much, David, and I remain at your side, whatever you need. I got millions of stories here. We didn't even scratch the surface.